Thank you very much. With this, we begin. Before going for the comparative study of the material mechanics, we will very quickly revise what is rubric. As you know, the rubric meaning, origin of the word rubric is from rubrique, from Middle English. It is meaning heading in red letters. We are very much aware about the word rubor. Rubor, we have studied in the cases of inflammation. One of the main sign of inflammation, there is a rubor. And what is that? Redness. And that is from the word rubrica, which is from Latin, or rubor. So rubor means red. So what is red? Red is something is very, what we want to highlight, we always underline with the red. Marks also we get into red, na? We write in blue, but marks are in red. What does it mean? That marks are important for which we are writing. So red is important, and that is what the word origin means, that it is in the red letters. So what does it mean? Red means something very essential, something very important. So depicting theme or title under which a thing is classified or category. That is what we mean by rubric. So all the categories what we classify, that is important, essential. Now, repertory. Repertory is what? Index. Thereby we are indexing the things so that we can find out very easily. And rubric is what? Where we are categorizing drugs as per the symptoms. So when we say rubric, it gives heading or title or represents the theme of we want to just say. So theme is something, a category. So I proceed further. So how we define rubric is, it has to be, it is a theme, it is a title, right? But the title of the entire symptom has to be concised into the theme. And when it is concised into the theme, it has to be exact, precisely it should be done. So the definition I put across is, it is a precise and concise heading or title or a keyword representing the common theme of symptoms. So there are so many symptoms which are giving the similar meaning. So we derive that common theme from all these symptoms of the same drug. Why same drug? Say Pulsatilla, proved in 10 patients, provers. So when they are proved in the 10 provers, what happens? All the provers may give the feeling of Pulsatilla, but maybe in the different words. Or various drugs represent the feeling of one particular structure for second. So 4 seconds may be presented by Pulsatilla also, Phosphorus also, Calcarea also. So many drugs are able to cure feeling of 4 seconds. So when we can treat that, so all these symptoms require to be together under rubric. The 4 seconds becomes the theme. Okay. So I'm just going very fast because our subject is a comparative study. I'm just revising what is rubric. Now rubric construction, we have two parts. One is symptom, another is drug part. Today we are focusing on the symptom part that we want to compare. Okay. Drug part is also important to compare, that say 4 seconds filling. So how Calcarea Gal 4 seconds is different from Pulsatilla 4 seconds or Hura 4 seconds. But there is a different study that we are not considering at this point of time, because in your exams, you are usually asked compare any particular two rubrics. So I proceed further. For comparative study of the rubrics, what we require to do, understand what constitutes comparison. I request the host to mute every participant, please. Hello. There is a lot of noise. Thank you. Host, please mute every participant. Hello, host. Are you there?
Yes, sir. Sir, I'm muting the participant.
Mute all the participants, please.
Thank you. Sir.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so now, how do we understand the comparison? So what the comparison constitutes? When we compare two things, it constitutes one thing that is similarity and another that is dissimilarity. So then only we have compared. It is not only dissimilarity or only similarity. And what is the purpose of this study of comparison? Why are we comparing it? What is the benefit when we compare? The benefit is one, it helps in your case taking. When we have studied the comparison, then it explores the symptoms precisely. Then you exactly know you are looking for gray or you are looking for black. You are looking for A or you are looking for B. So in case taking, so many things look alike. Patient says, "Mujhe bura lagta hai. I feel bad. I don't understand what is bad." So we have to go into the detail. Bad means what? Then patient says, "Bad means mala vait vartat." But what does that mean? Patient says, "I feel angry. Mujhe cheed aati hai." So now, how do we understand anger and cheed? So we have to, if I understand what is gussa and if I understand what is cheed, then I can differentiate both from the content that patient is telling me. So precisely it helps me in the case taking for defining the case precisely. Very important is we want accuracy. Second point is case processing. To convert every symptom into correct rubric, there lies our success of the prescription. So it is very essential in case processing. If I understand the comparison, then I would know whether I will take absent-minded or I will take forgetful, whether I will take cautious or I will take careful, whether I take anger or I take irritability. So these particular shades, which we'll understand only from the study of the comparative, similar mind liking rubrics. And third is remedy selection. That is for our entire purpose is there. So we have to select the remedy, and that remedy selection, now this year in your portion, what is added is PDF, potential differential field. So this field or this exercise has the capacity to differentiate the drugs. So all the particular rubrics, the specific rubrics, small rubrics, they have to be taken in the PDF. The dispositional features, important symptom but vague symptoms or very huge rubrics, they will come in the part of PDF so that you can select whether the drug which you are comparing is covered by which of the symptoms for curing as per the totality of symptoms. Okay, so remedy selection, right particular rubric will help through PDF in selection of remedy. Okay, so we will study anger versus irritability to begin with. I will give you some examples. How will we study rubrics? Now, how will we study rubrics? So what will be the steps? The first step is we have to define the rubrics. We have to understand meaning of the rubrics. So first thing is, how will we define the rubrics? So we define rubrics if we understand the word origin. And if there are many words in one rubric, for example, carried, desire to be fast, four words. Carried, desire to be fast, 5 words. So every word I have to break and understand. Carried. What is carried? What is the difference between carried and held desire to be? Carried desire to be and held desire to be. Held, you are holding something, right? So it is possessed. It is grasped. It is grasped something. But in carried, it is not just grasped. It is the movement from to. So you grasp also from some place and you put it at some place. So to. So grasp and movement. And that is how we study held or hold desire to be and carried desire to be. Then what is desire? What is to be? So that way we have to break it to understand what is desire. Desire is urge. So my urge is that I should be carried. Okay? So that is how you study rubrics. So first thing, we break the all the components of the rubric. So all the words we understand with regards to origin of the word. So word origin. But now I understand we have a limitation. We can't understand old English, Latin words, Greek words. That we do it here so that that will help you to add to your understanding. So in exam, I understand that it will not be possible to remember all the origin of the words. If you can do it, it is fine. But otherwise, our focus is definition of the word. And then our focus is explanation of the word. So a definition of the rubric, explanation of the rubric. Then where is this rubric located in the repertory? So chapter name, rubric name, sub-rubric name. If it is saving sub-rubric. If your what you are studying is a sub-rubric, then sub-rubric name. So likewise, you give the address of the rubric. How will you give address of the rubric? I will tell you. It is very simple. The moment you say, where is the symptom? So when it comes where, it is location. So that becomes a chapter. I get anger. Anger. Where do I get mind? So mind is a chapter. I get anxiety in stomach. So where am I getting symptom? In stomach. So where is the chapter? Stomach is the chapter. Very clear? So where is the chapter? So always ask, this symptom is felt in which part? So location is chapter. Then second point, what is the problem? The moment you say what becomes the rubric? And then further parts which are define the what in terms of why, how, when. So all those become sub-rubric. Okay? So when we are studying comparison of the... So first thing what we have to study the definition of the rubric, means meaning of the rubric, explanation of the rubric, location of the rubric, and then examples of the rubric. Okay, so I will just demonstrate that in a little bit for anger and irritability. Now write down, take your paper and pen, write down what is anger, gussa, irritability, chid. But what does that mean, anger? How is it different from irritability? I understand, but how would I put that into words? So let us understand. Anger and irritability. Anger. In the Middle English, it is from anger, ranger. It means distress, affliction, hostile attitude, strong displeasure. So when this is coming from the old Middle English, it is giving that person is not comfortable. It is not happiness. It is a feeling of distressful And in the distress, there is a hostility, means there is an aggression. I would attack. So that is hostile attitude. And it is not the mild, anger is not the mild, but it is a strong displeasure, strong distress. So whereby I become hostile. So moment I understand word origin, I start understanding, and then it is easy for me to describe. Okay. See, now anger we say gussa, but old Norse, that is Germanic language, North Germanic language. So in the North German, in the old time, it was anger. Anger is means grief. We have another rubric, grief. So we understand grief with a different understanding. But mind well, I will just tell you. In the grief, grief means what? When I lose, the means loss of my beloved person, beloved things, beloved power, beloved position, what I desired the most, which I loved the most, which was possessed by me. Hai na? Mobile gum ho jata hai. Dukhi ho jate ho ki nahi? Abhi wo jo dukh hota hai, when we are sad about it, the first thing that comes up is anger. Asa kasa harevla tu? I accuse myself only, right? I reproach myself. How is it that I lost it? I should have done this. I should have taken care of. I should have given medicine at the right time. I should have taken to the hospital in the this particular manner. Why did I go by rickshaw? I should have taken care. So all these, the first reaction of grief is always anger. There is a, and anger is not the feeling of happiness. It is feeling of sadness. So that is why anger and grief, they come very close. But grief proceeds also further. In it is four steps. So we'll do grief at some other time. But I am talking about the anger, which meant grief in very old time. Another is the, in the old Norse only, anger means vexed, to be vexed, vexation. Anger. Now you see, grief, vex, now the Latin meaning is suffocation, anguish. To choke, cause pain too, squeeze, strangle. Anger also means suffocation. Now you see, one who is getting angry is not cornered or forced or is not given any choice to act otherwise. And in that situation, he becomes hostile with distress to defend himself or to express that how one is troubled. Are you with me? Anger. The other meanings, if we understand the word origin, then we understand the experience of the person who is getting angry. Okay. It is also narrow, distressing. So choking. In choking, what is happening? Narrowing down. Strangling. When one is strangled, what is happening? Narrow down. Can't breathe. Suffocating. Right? And so in Old English, anger means also narrow. Irritability. Irritability means to irritate. It is from word irritate. Latin word irritate. Means to excite. Provoke. somebody is irritated, means has been excited, has been provoked. Okay? Excite means what? To initiate something. Provoke. Something is very calm, quiet, and things are happening properly. And somebody provokes, na? You are studying and brother comes and provokes you. So we go further and understand what is the word meaning of anger and how it means to irritability. Anger is a strong feeling of displeasure, usually of antagonism. See here, I am angry. When I am angry, I am not the only party. There is some party which is strangling, which is twisting, which is forcing, which is going against me. Then I get angry. Now this may be a person, this may be a situation, this may be a climate, this can be anything. Which is, so in anger, there is always antagonism. In anger, there is something opposite. And that opposite is pressurizing, forcing me. And so, now what is antagonism means? Opposition of a conflicting force, tendency or principle. Opposition of a conflicting force, tendency or principle. Siddhant. Principle means Siddhant. I don't agree to certain rules. I don't agree to certain principles that is imposed. So I oppose it. So I apply the conflicting force. And this is a hostile reaction to opposition. Okay? So that is what is the antagonism. So it is a strong feeling of displeasure, usually whereby there is an opposition of a conflicting force. In hostile way, you oppose it. Okay? So there is anger. Another meaning of anger is inflammation. Tissue inflammation, we say, and in our mathematics also it is written, that was looking very angry. The inflamed tissue was looking very angry, hypersal. Tissue is not doing angry, but it was so red, inflamed. So what is inflammation means? In flame means on fire. So on fire, that what does it produce? Heat. It produces redness. And that is what in anger, what do we find? Hum bolte na, bhai iti tapto ka is, kyun itna garam ho raha hai bhai? To gussa, inflammation mein kya hota hai? Garam hota hai. Ya, koi bolte, wo itna gussa ho gaya, uska chehra ekdam lal lal ho gaya tha. Inflammation. So anger, word meaning is inflammation. On fire. Irritability. Property of getting excited or provoked to react with annoyance to harassing stimuli. This is something very important. In anger, there is a action. There is opposition. There is strong repulsion. I don't want it. And there is a lot of distress going on inside. Whereas in irritability, what is it? If harassing stimuli, I constantly provoking, then it produce annoyance. So somebody tells you something. भाई समय हो गया पढ़ ले, अभी तक क्या कर रहा है, अभी तक पढ़ा नहीं, पढ़ने बैठ जा, ये टीवी पे देख रहा है, पढ़ने बैठ जा, क्या व्हाट्सएप पे लगा है, अभी भी तुझे कितनी बार बोला, चार बार बोला, अभी तक पढ़ नहीं रहा है, पढ़ ले. Then the subject will start harassment. अरे एक बार बोला मालूम है ना, मुझे पढ़ना है, मैं पढ़ लूंगा ना. This is annoyance. That is irritability. And anger means there is a definite state of antagonism. क्या बात करते हो, मुझे क्यों बोल रहे हो, मैं क्यों करूंगा, तू ऐसा मेरे को मत कर, I want that you go away, get out. It is anger. Because in anger there is a purpose to hurt somebody. Whatever I want to not only force away you, but I want to harm you and hurt you. There is also one meaning of anger, to harm and hurt the opposite person with whom you are not angry and you are antagonizing with the person. That is also one dictionary meaning of anger. And irritability is feeling of harassment. Okay, so annoy means to harass or disturb by repeated acts, repeatedly if somebody is poking. What is the similarity and dissimilarity? Similarity is that in both they are feeling distress and there is a sense of disapproval. I don't agree, don't poke me, I don't agree, don't impose on me. Okay. So, in both, there is a sense of disapproval and displeasure. So, in both, it appears similar at this level. But what is a dissimilar? Anger means results due to antagonism or feeling of forced, strangulated, twisted. Somebody is twisting you. There is no choice. Somebody corners you. And hence anger is to express opposition in aggressive way, which invariably hurts the opposite person. You are opposing aggressively so that other person is hurt. There is a harm to him. And inflame means to make angry, to excite. It meant to set fire. Okay? Irritability means reaction of displeasure to repeated stimuli, testing threshold of a person, hence giving sense of harassment to him. It is sahanshilta check karte aap. You are checking what? The threshold of the person. One time, two time, three time. It is enough now. So that is irritability. So it is a sense of displeasure with a repeated stimuli, which breaks the threshold of the person. Okay? So you understand both. What is anger? What is irritability? Force is different. Though displeasure of disapproval is there within. But in one, you are defending yourself by severe opposition, by you are aggressively, with a hostile act, you are pushing away somebody, and then invariably that hurts the opposite person. Okay? Whereas in irritability, you are expressing displeasure to express that you are harassed. So there is, you are expressing the annoyance and you don't want that stimuli to continue. In practice, how do we apply? Anger has aggression to disapproval, expressed or suppressed, and invariably hurts. If it is suppressed, then it hurts the person himself. If it is expressed, it can express the outrageously and it hurts the opposite person. And irritability means is a reaction to harassing stimuli with expression of displeasure and annoyance. Okay, so that is how you will recognize in the practice. So anger, he complained of headache after anger. This is an example of anger, which he preferred not to express after undue blames and insults from boss in front of his peers. Here he is going into maybe suppressed anger. Irritability is this continuous noise disturbing his meditation that irritates her. So continuous noise, stimuli, which I don't approve, and that is harassing me. So I get annoyed. And anger what? That I was insulted, blamed. I don't like that kind of behavior of yours that in front of peers are insulting me. I don't want that. That is anger. Let us see the small film. I hope it is audible to all. It is animated. Even if you don't able to see, watch it carefully. Very self-explanatory. See the smile. How happy he is. Yes. Oh, what happened? See. Now see the expression on the. Oh. See the expression. Ah. So you got irritated. Now you see what is happening. He doesn't agree the behavior and he's opposing it with lots of aggression. You see the aggression. Yeah. Now you see the change. Ah. You see the heat? You see the fire? He is happy that only he has 15. Oh, what is it all happening? See, anger is always a double-edged sword. It hurts other. At the same time, it definitely hurts the person who is doing your anger. Tell me, what is this? Anger? Write your. This is anger. And this is what? Irritability. See the aggression, opposition, hostile reaction. And the first one is only feeling the harassment. Now you see, this is with fire. So what it must be? Right you are. This is anger. And this is irritated. This fellow is irritated. So this is irritability. It is in mind chapter of the Ken Shepherd-Tree. Rubrics are anger, irascibility, and irritability. So now, rubric is not only anger in Ken Shepherd, it is anger, irascibility. So what is irascibility? Irascibility is coming from root ira, which means anger. The same root that gives us the word ire means anger. We say na ire. Okay. Now in irascibility, IRA is anger. What is SC? SC means becoming. So becoming angry. Now, bility means what? So irascible doesn't just mean you are angry, but it's got action built in it. Ability means you are capable of doing it. So becoming angry and you are capable of expressing it, that is irascibility. So do you understand this? Okay. There are 37 participants. You have any questions, or I go to the another comparison? We have about 20 minutes. Questions? Okay, no questions. I proceed further. जी सबको म्यूट कर दीजिए ना प्लीज म्यूट एवरीबॉडी ओके सो नाउ आई गो टू द अनदर वन लेट अस टेक अप दिस वन ओके इंटरेस्टिंग वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग दे लुक सो अलाइक कोजेशन versus careful. So cautious versus careful. Cautious versus careful. So when we go to the report dictionary, cautious is given careful, careful is given cautious, but we have two different rubrics. So how do we understand cautious versus careful? Same way we go, but now I will go a little fast because you understood the process. So careful. What is careful and what is cautious? Word origin. Care means sorrow, worry, to be concerned. In Boni Hussain's characteristics and repertory, in the aggression chapter, it is given sadness, sorrow, grief, care, etc. aggravate. So care is sorrow, worry. Okay? Whereas cautious comes from the word one who is having the caution, to be on one's guard, that is caution. So what is the, now here we understand what is concern. Concern means to sift. Concern means sift. Sift means what? Sort out what is useful and what is not useful. As if putting through a sieve. Sieve means kya? Chai ke time hum log wo girni use karte hai na? That is sieving the tea. Okay? So, concern is shift. Shift, what it happens, it helps you to very clear for you what is important for you, what is useful to you. So you are caring about what? You are having the sorrow or you are worrying about something important for you. You are caring that it is 7 o'clock, but yet daddy has not come. So daddy is important for you. You care for that. Because you are concerned for that means daddy is very useful or important part of you. Okay? You mix with daddy. So there is part of yourself. Since it is part of yourself, you worry for it because it is important for you. Now let us understand what is guard. Guard means defend, to watch. Defend means it is opposite to offend. In anger, you offend. To defend yourself, right? So guard defends yourself, is watchful. Watch means alert, is very alert, is alarmed. Yes, what is going to happen? Okay. So careful and cautious, they are coming from the word full of care. That is careful. Okay. So word meaning is careful means. Care, painstaking effort to avoid errors or omission. You are careful. You are full of care about something you are worrying because that is important to you. You are concerned for it. That is why you are worrying. Okay. So, since it is important for you and you are worrying, you see that you don't commit any omission or the mistakes. So, careful means painstaking effort to avoid errors or omission being concerned. Whereas, cautious means watchful to avoid impending danger or risk. It means you are very alert. You are alert for what? To see. You anticipate a danger or the risk to come. So, are you getting the point? You are taking care and you are cautious. Okay. And when you are cautious, you are in the lookout for that there can be impending, which there can be possibility of danger. So what is the similarity? Both appear similar as there being sense of alertness. In both you are alert. Hence, in regular talk, many times you are using one for the another. So when the rubric, when you use, you have one for the another, such rubrics we call it as cross-reference. So cautious becomes cross-reference for careful. What is because of similarity, you may be mistaking one for the another. So that is why it is cross-reference. Whereas abundant is synonym for forsaken, deserted. So they all have the same meaning. So they are synonym. So that is why drugs are given only in one rubric. Any one rubric it can be given. So instead of abundant, it is given in forsaken. But whereas when there are similar rubrics, cautious and careful, absent-minded, and forgetful, anger and irritability. They are cross-reference of each other. So rubrics are given in each rubric. Drugs are given in each rubric because each rubric has its own different meaning. But they are look-alike. They are not same. So same is synonym. Look-alike means cross-reference. So for your study of comparative rubrics, cross-reference will come. Not synonyms will come. Okay. So cautious and careful, both are cross-reference of each other, whereas there is a sense of alertness. Chokanne rehte hum log, right? Lekin, what is the difference? Chokanna kam rehte. This similarity kya hai? Cautious mein, that there is a sense of impending, means approaching, anticipated risk. Abhi risk hai? There is no risk at this point of time. But I expect there will be risk. I anticipate there will be a problem. So there is a threatened danger. That is cautiousness. Whereas in carefulness, it is a matter of concern where one is engaged to the task. When I'm engaged with the task, when I'm giving you a lecture, I have to be careful. But I will be cautious that when I'm giving a lecture, there is a possibility if my internet fails. So I'm having an impending danger that something may go wrong. Whereas when I'm giving lecture, I have to be careful that my task goes well without any mistake. So I tell that, okay, continue to check internet. If my Wi-Fi goes away, immediately swift over to my hotspot. It is a matter of my concern that I should not have any mistake. Okay? So when I applied that into the practice, cautious is before. Okay, thank you. So the question is beforehand, because I anticipate it, it alerts me. Jeevala dhoka hai. Danger. We get all those signs. There is caution. There is caution. It is making you cautious. There is careful is, it is during act. While during exam, you have to be careful that you don't make mistake. So you write properly. So you are concerned and you are focusing that there is no omission or commission of the mistake. That is careful. And caution is, when you are passing by, caution. Floor is wet. Be careful. That can be risk for you. Right? Are you getting the point? Beforehand is caution. And while the task, it is careful. Surgeon was careful while suturing and at time of counting towels towards the end of surgery. Surgeon has to be careful, right? And at the task, that not forceps or any towel is left inside the abdomen cavity. So they count the towels. Caution. Cautious. He became cautious by the sign of beware of dogs. When I went, I was entering, there was a signboard. Beware of the dogs. Oh, my God, dog may bite me. So, beforehand, chetavni. Chetavni is cautious. It makes you cautious. Chetavni means caution. It makes you cautious. Now, what is this? This picture, they are cautious or careful? Right, they are careful because they are on the task. They are crossing the river, they are on the task. And if they have one omission, they will fall on in the river. So they have to be totally concerned about what they are doing and alert while doing. So it is a careful. This is cautious, right? Now, to be careful is the important thing, right? Then how it becomes a rubric? Rubric means it is a symptom. Symptom means it is a point of distress. Distress means when person does not have the control on himself and invariably he is seen careful. So we understand that there is no point to be careful at this point of time. But he's invariably careful. So when he's invariably careful, it means that has become the disposition, a tendency of the person. So when it becomes a tendency of the person, person's own control on over it goes away. So invariably he tend to do that, and so he suffers. That is why such quality of the person, to be fastidious, to be careful, to be courageous, to be cheerful. These are the ones out of the way of beyond the capacity of the person. That is why they require to be corrected. They are now the point of distress for the person. Jahan usko khush nahi hona chahiye, wahan wo khush ho gaya. Ki kisi ki maiyat mein bhi wo to cheerful hai. That is not the right thing. So something striking, strange, rare, peculiar, out of the place, or intensity that makes it characteristic. So that is why such characteristic thing we require to correct and make it normal. So that is why they require treatment. So such things we require to check. So chapter is mind, rubrics are careful and cautious, they are straightway given. Okay. So antonym. You can also write antonym in your exam. Antonym is synonym is same. Antonym is not same. Opposite. So opposite of careful is what? Careless. What is the rubric of careless in Kane Shepherdry? Okay. Heedless. In Kane Shepherdry, it is printed wrong. It is printed as a headless. It is not headless. It is original word is heedless. So careful, its synonym is heedless. And what is the antonym of cautious? Is audacious. Audacious means foolishly courageous. He simply overlooks all the danger. That is audacious. So cautious will be very, very much at the guard with the anticipation of something wrong can happen. That is cautious. And audacious is bindas, found there. And he overlooks all the alarms or signals. So this is antonym. Okay. These are the drug list for careful and cautious, important drugs. These are all the drugs so far known. You may not remember every drug, but if you can, you can just write down careful some of the drugs. Okay. So this is about another comparison. I just want to know whether I can continue, because I was told to give lecture for 50 minutes. I had to restrict myself to 50 minutes. So host Sachinderji, can I continue or I have to stop here? Hello, am I audible? Hello. Okay, in the chat box, some any questions by any students? Okay, I'll take very briefly for five more minutes. I will take one set. Anxiety and fear, you want to do? Hello. Can I continue or time is over?
Time is over, sir.
Okay.
Take part two next time.
Okay, so thank you very much, MUHS team, for such a wonderful coordination. And I also appreciate all the participants for being with us.